Singer, songwriter, producer, DJ, author, playwright. Did I forget anything today?
I was pretty good at mixing cement too. In bad times.
Have you done that? Have you been over New York? Have you done the building thing? Have you?
Not as much as probably other people did, but my brother Jemmy is from here too. Had a construction company, so when things get really bad, he would get me into mix cement. So I became pretty good. Instead of mixing cement, I was good at that.
You're in the music business. It's going to get bad.
It's been bad. I hope it's not getting any worse.
No, I think you've done pretty good so far. We'll go through your entire career and talk about things. You left here when you were 19. You left Wexford when you were 19.
Yeah.
But the one thing I know nothing about is what you got up to prior to that. I presume you were playing in Wexford here.
Yeah, I was in groups and show bands and folk bands. It was a very mixed scene. You know, Jackie Sinnott was around the time, Pierce Turner, Bernie Barrett. It was a whole scene here in Wexford. And Wexford is always a very musical town. And so it was folk bands, it was rock bands. And then I was at the tail end of the whole show band thing, too. I actually played here as in a show band.
You played here when it was the town hall.
The town hall, yeah. I've got to talk about that tonight.
Well, considering that the Arts Centre is now 40 years old, we're giving away
great. Oh, I don't care. I was here in the time of Teddy Boys, the Taylor, because Wexford has always had, youth fashions and everything. But with the Teddy Boys, they stayed for a really long time. Mm. And a lot of violence. There's a lot of violence mixed up with music here in Wexford. I was kind of from the other side of the tracks, but I got into the whole working class rock and roll show band scene, which was great. And I stayed on the other side of the tracks from then on. It was a lot more fun.
But I mean, you must kind of. The show band era is kind of hasn't been referenced really now, but I mean, it informed an awful lot of the music that came from Ireland since then.
Because the big reason was you played with horns. So, like with Black 47, we had a saxophone, a trombone, an Irish Ulan pipe. So, from being in a show band, I basically knew how to arrange horns, which was a big thing.
See, that's a bit of a revelation now. So, you're kind of telling me that Black 47 are sort of like a 21st century show band, effectively.
Well, not really, but the experience, there were elements, definitely, in that we were friendly with the audiences too, or hostile, as the case might be. Yeah. It was an odd mixture of a band, but the great thing about being in a show band was that you had to play whatever was in the top 20. So you had to learn how to play in every key. Mm. Whereas if you were playing in a garage band, playing to yourself, you tend to play in the rock and roll keys of E and A or, whatever was easy. Yeah. And on top of everything else, the horn players in Wexford, I realized later, I didn't know anything about them at first, were kind of lazy. They only wanted to play in G and C and D.
They haven't changed an awful lot in
So fairness. You had to learn how to play, because the horns are a tone higher, so you had to learn to play an F and B flat and E flat, which were real pains to be in a show band in the early days, or when you were starting out. But you did learn that, so you could play in every key, and you had to learn to play every type of song that was in the top 20.
And of course, it was a great learning experience. I mean, actually copying that music as well.
Yeah, it was a real learning experience. I can't say I was that great at it, but. And then the other thing was I played on the town a lot and on the key in pickup bands with a guy called Johnny Wreck, where you would go out and you do the first hour yourself, and then people from the audience would come up and they would sing, and they would expect you to catch them in their key within two or three bars. Yeah, so I'd be looking around saying, what's wrong with this guy? It was an odd band too. I was playing guitar. There would be a drummer, and Johnny Reck played a trumpet and a Hawaiian guitar.
Wow.
So I had to catch the chords. Yeah, so you got really good at learning chords.
Excellent. So that was W. And then around that time as well, I mean, I can't remember, I can't put a time on it exactly, but the first appearance of Liverpool Fantasy, was that before you left?
No, that was after I left.
Because I seem to remember, because I would have been, I guess, in my teens when you held that, you put that on first, was it in, down in Oyster Lane?
Oyster Lane.
Just to explain, Liverpool Fantasy is basically a story about the Beatles don't actually make it, and Paul McCartney, the blue-eyed soul boy, is the... becomes the solo act, basically, isn't that
right? Yeah, he goes to Vegas, and then there's no 60s. Mm. And the other Beatles are back in Liverpool. George is a priest, a Jesuit. Ringo is playing with Jerry and the Pacemakers, and John is an unemployed docker.
It all kind of makes sense, really, doesn't it?
Yeah, in a certain way. We were also into the Beatles here, and into Liverpool, that picked up on that.
Yeah,
but it had been done in New York, and then a very different production. Now I came over here, it was totally a working class kind of production. It was great.
Was it in Oyster Lane, was it?
It was in Oyster Lane, yeah.
With
Michael.
Michael Way.
Gary was in it.
That's where Gary Lydon was in it.
Yeah, Gary Lydon was in it. Who else? There's a lot. John Billington.
John was in it, was he really?
It was a great crowd of heads. I mean, they went to Liverpool and auditioned Liverpool actors and brought, I think, about 5 Liverpool actors over, so it was one big party.
Excellent. And you got a message from Paul McCartney as well.
That was really funny. That was later, though. That was when it was done at the Dublin Theatre Festival. Uh-huh. It was a group that came from New York, and Paul sent us a telegram, and we went out to one of the bars, and we were showing it around, we passed it around, and then come the end of the night, we're saying, who has the telegram? And it passed on to someone who put it in their pocket.
I guarantee it's in somebody's wallet still. Somebody still has it.
They're saying not now.
Tell you one thing, if I got that telegraph, I'm like, I'd be
all about the same thing. I didn't blame them.
Oh, God, that's awful. That's awful. So anyway, you went over to New York when you were 19. I mean, was that kind of informed? Did Wexford not hold enough? Or was it bad times? Did you just feel that?
No, I went for adventure. I'd seen Midnight Cowboy. I want a piece of that.
Did you go with Pierce around the same
time?
No,
I went first, and then I stayed there for 5 months, and then I came back. And Pierce and I had lived together in Dublin, and he was in the Arrows show band. And we bought Pierce out of the Arrows, and we went back that January 1st, whatever it was.
Yeah.
So we formed a group over there.
Yeah, you did. I mean, that was Kirwan and Turner. Of Wexford.
Yeah, or Turner and Kirwan.
Turner and Kirwan.
No one could say it right. People used to say Turner and Kirwan. It was all mixed up. But we were pretty mixed up too. It was wild.
Yeah, no, I believe that. I mean, there was sex and drugs and rock and roll going on there, you know?
Yeah, it was a wild band, and it was in the 70s over there, and we were living right next to CBGB, so we were part of that whole scene.
Yeah, that was a fairly hedonistic kind of, time and place.
Oh, it's great. It was wild over there, because as long as you didn't kill anyone, you could do anything you liked. Yeah, so it was hard to fit back into Wexford when you came back.
Yeah, you know that.
Because we were there 3 years illegally. We couldn't come back. And then by the time I came back, I was living by that stage way deep in the East Village and the Puerto Rican and black neighborhood. And I'd become more part of that scene. And I came back to Wexford. It just felt... That's strange.
Yeah,
Pierce was able to fit back in a little better because he kept roots more here, I think.
Yeah, I mean, at that stage you were doing kind of, I suppose, folk rock, really, but kind of, there was kind of progressive experimental kind of things going on there as well.
I think of it now. Pierce is playing a Moog synthesizer on top of a clavinet and played a hi-hat with his left foot. And I was playing a really heavily... just a lot of affected acoustic guitar and kicking a bass drum at the same time. So it was a big sound.
It sounds like a good sound to me. And how did that go for you? I mean, that was how long? That was what, 3-4 years or longer, was it?
Yeah, longer. And we had almost a hit. We had a song called "A Girl Next Door," which is the first song of a lesbian to get played on the radio ever, and. That was nearly a hit. That album, Absolutely and Completely, was kind of big on progressive rock stations in the States. And then we got tired of sitting down. We wanted to play standing up, and we went a lot punkier, and then the whole new wave thing came in. And we got a record deal with CBS and toured with Cyndi Lauper a lot, and UB40 were in that scene. And then we got dropped by the record label, as always happens.
Was that Major Thinker's time?
Yeah, Major Thinker's time.
You have to be careful of that. That's another name you have to be careful of, you know, because it comes out as Major Thinker's quite a bit, you know?
You know, Major Thinker's is the worst name you could possibly have, because if someone's going to criticize you, they had the ammunition. Yeah, I mean, there was one criticism of, it was a show there, and they were talking about the three different bands, and they talked about the first two bands, and, they were saying, this band are Major Thinkers, this band are Major Thinkers, the Major Thinkers are not.
It's like calling your boat the unsinkable, really, isn't
it? Yeah,
yeah. You're just asking for trouble, really. But I mean, you know, I mean, a lot of people kind of say that the Major Thinkers were quite a departure from Turner and Kirwan. But I mean, actually, I kind of see it more as a progression. They were a new wave band, but I mean,
yeah,
and it was with them as well, you had a bigger hit with Avenue B.
Yeah, Avenue B. Avenue B would have been a big hit. It was a big radio hit, except we always made the wrong decisions. We insisted that it get out straight away because it was on the radio, so it came out without any kind of a cover on it, the album. Mm. So it's still called the Black Album.
got there before Prince.
Yeah, before Prince. We were always making mistakes like that. You know, in good faith, we thought that was the way to go about it, but it didn't work out. No, I thought it was a progression from Turner and Kirwan. It's just, we wanted to dance. Yeah. It's like, you got more girls if you dance. You can get them sitting down as easy. Yeah.
One of the great things about getting people dancing as well, it's a great way of keeping time, watching them sway, you know?
Yeah.
Especially when you're in those gigs when you can hear absolutely nothing on stage, you know?
Exactly.
You know? So that was the Major Thinkers. And I've got to apologize, by the way. And I get my chance to apologize now. We had a bootleg at home with the Major Thinkers for a long time with a nice little photocopied insert of a review of the album.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I'm sorry.
No, the bootleg we put out ourselves.
Oh, was that?
We called it bootleg because...
That might have been it then.
Yeah, that was quite so guilty. It was a mixture of songs that we recorded and we decided, let's bootleg it ourselves. Some of them were owned by record companies, so we had to do it that way.
Oh, nice one. Bootlegging your own stuff.
Yeah.
Nice. And then that brings us up to around the period of Black 47.
Well, when we got dropped at a record company, I just didn't really want to go on in music. I really didn't think I had anything to say anymore. I was kind of sick of myself as a musician. So I decided to become a playwright, and Pierce went on to have a solo career. So for 4 years, I didn't even listen to music. Really that much. I have no idea what went on, say, between 85 and 89 in music. I just stopped listening. I mean, I listened to jazz, I listened to a lot of Miles Davis and world music and Irish trad I got back into. But I didn't listen to pop music. I got totally out of it, just totally into the theater, producing plays and writing them. I was just totally involved in that. And one night, I had become so much into writing that I didn't go out anymore. I was like into characters. And one night I think I had maybe a little bit of a breakdown. I just couldn't take it anymore. I thought, I go nuts. You know, for another thing is I had stopped meeting any Irish people. And I thought, I really want to hear some Irish voices. It's a really strange thing because I'm hearing American voices all the time. I was living in Soho at the time. And there was a bar called Eamon Duran's up in the 50s, the same one that's owned in Temple Bar, the same people. And I started to walk up towards the 50s, up Second Avenue. And I was passing by a place called Paddy Riley's, and I heard some music in there. And I thought, well, let me stop and I'll have a shot in here. And I went to the bar, and I had a shot, and I was listening to the band it was on. And the singer, or the piper from the band, knew me from the Major Thinkers, and he asked me to get up and play. I was like, nah, the last thing I want to do is play. I just want to sit and listen. Mm. And the bartender said, here's another shot. Get your ass up on stage. And it was this woman, Dimna, from Cabin. So I drank the shot, and I got up, and I think, I don't know what to play. And Chris said, just play it anyway, man. You know, I need a break. Mm-hmm. The band needs a break. So I got up and I played and played for about an hour and I felt great after it. And then I was sitting with Chris afterwards and I could see this is really late. We've been there for maybe 8 hours at this point. And I could see he was depressed and I said, what's the matter? And he said, well, the band I'm in here is called Beyond the Pale is breaking up tonight. I had 6 weeks of gigs. I don't know what to do. And I said, I'll go with you. He said, what should we call ourselves? And I said, there's only one name. If I'm going to do it, it has to be Black 47, because it has to be a political band and it has to mean something. And Chris is very political anyway. So he said, yeah, all right. So we went and we did his gigs.
And that's how you met Chris Byrne, the Ellen Pike player, Black 47. So you had 10 years together then playing.
10 years, yeah. Chris left in 2000.
Yeah.
May 2000. We started in November 1989. We finished up last Saturday. Exactly 25 years. We planned it for a year to do that.
Yeah.
So Chris and I played together for about 11 years, 10, 11
yeah,
years.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, it's funny you say, you did say you set up the band as a political figure.
Totally. Yeah.
And how much of that was informed by, let's say, you're from here, from Wexford? I mean, was there a certain amount of, you know, the kind of the Danny Boy syndrome where I always hated that song until I found myself crying, singing it in a bar in the Bronx? Like, you know, was it that kind of, you're away from home?
No.
And I kind of put it, or did you actually go to America with those kind of feelings kind of in?
Well, I was always political. I was raised by a political grandfather just down the street in Georgia Street. He was very Republican, but he was in a free state town, so he always kept it quiet, but he would always talk to me about it. And I was very much into the left-wing side of things, James Connolly, Jim Larkin thing. And then the difference when you go to the Bronx, once you're out of Ireland for about 5 years, you're kind of cleansed of the whole, the British cultural media that just washes over Wexford. When you're here, you don't actually realize it because you're watching British television. Even if you're against it, you're kind of, it's kind of soaks into you.
Yeah, yeah.
When you're away from it for about 5 years, you're just divorced from it. You can see things a lot clearer, you know. You can make up your mind about things. And there was a lot of stuff going on in the North at that point, having gone on for a long time of, trial by jury and everything. So even if you weren't, say, an IRA fellow traveler, you saw things differently because for the first time also, you were actually living and being around people from Tyrone and West Belfast and mm-hmm. Derry.
Right.
So you were seeing things from a different point of view, how it was kind of territorial, how the British Army was sitting on these people in their own environments. So you got a different view of the political side of things. And then with Black 47, it was a left-wing type of thing too. So that led into the Iraq album and everything.
Okay. I mean, yeah, that was informed by, I mean, there was quite a lot of ex-servicemen that used to come to your gigs as well. I mean, how did that sit? How did Iraq sit with people in America? I mean, were there certain elements of people saying, you know, an Irish band has no right to be talking about this? I mean, you know, did they appreciate the kind of the leftist view of
they weren't saying things, they were screaming things. It was like, it was three of the worst years of my life, actually.
Was it really?
From 2003, the war started actually St. Patrick's Night on 2003, and we came out against it really strongly, and there was fights breaking out through the whole club and everything. I mean,
yeah.
We were playing... I forget what we're playing. It's downtown. It was in the shadow of the World Trade, so it was electric down there.
Mm.
And then I wrote all the songs over the next couple of years. But what I was doing really was, Black 47 had its audience tended to be working class, lower middle class, because we had an audience through the whole society, but that was the big, that was our big demographic. So a lot of those people tend to go into the army because it's a job,
mm.
or they go into the reserves where you go in for one weekend a year, and out of that,
yeah.
you can get a loan to buy a house or whatever.
Yeah.
So a lot of our fans, unlike, say, most rock bands, were in Iraq and in Afghanistan. So we were, and we've always kept a thing, anybody writes to the band, I reply to them. So I was getting more information back about what was actually going on than I would say the New York Times was. Because I was getting it directly from the troops. I mean, as they were going up into Baghdad, they were getting shot at, and they were thinking, what's going on? You know, they're supposed to be, greeting us with flowers and open arms. So I knew right from the start it was a bad thing. So with the songs on the Iraq album, I wasn't copying them from the letters, but I was using the characters in the letters and what was actually going on. But yeah, it was uproar, because we always had a strong right wing, say cops and firemen, say, and a left wing of students and workers and revolutionaries. So the right wing went nuts, basically, and we destroyed ourselves in a lot of circles in conservative circles, in conservative gigs, which we always did really well at. We were the big Irish festivals band.
Yeah.
So it was uproar for 3 years. Every night you go on stage, there would be threats and people getting up, walking out, smashing your CDs. But then I was thinking, some nights I would say, tonight I won't do any Iraq songs. And halfway through the set, I'd have a shot or something, and I think, hell with these. You know, some guy over there, our fan is over there with 100 pounds on his back and 120 degrees of heat. So yeah. I'm feeling bad here, drinking whiskey. Some idiot out in front of me who doesn't like it. So it was wild, huh?
But I'm surprised that you found that particularly awkward, because, I mean, Black 47 has been quite contentious all the way along. I mean, there was an awful lot of people said that you didn't act like an Irish band. I mean, you combined hip hop and rap and reggae and horn sections and jazz and all sorts of stuff. So, and you weren't afraid. I mean, you were bringing in subjects, you were talking about the disenfranchised in many different ways. I mean, not only the immigrant situation, but of course, republicanism and all that. And you were bringing that to the attention. And I think you were informing people as well. I mean, the set that were kind of like, wanted to sit in the nice sort of diddly idol sort of set. And I think you may have kind of broadened a few people, but there was quite a bit of contention there as well.
There was a lot. And we were very involved in gay rights too. And that was big. And that was really intense. And the song Danny Boy became really big.
I was going to say, it's an unromantic. I mean, I love the juxtaposition. I mean, the thing is, you've got a song which is ostensibly about an Irish builder, and it's a song about bigotry, and you automatically think, well, this is going to be about racism. But the thing that he gets given out to about is the fact that he's possibly gay. He is gay. But I mean, and that whole kind of the juxtaposition of what it's one sort of racism that you think the song might be, and it turns out to be a completely different racism, that must have been quite challenging as well for some of the more right wing elements of your.
Well, they used to say for about 3 months or so at festivals, they would say, we love Black 47, but could you do us a favor and not do Danny Boy? And I said, thank you for reminding me. I wasn't going to do it. He used to drive them nuts. And then he stopped. Don't ask him. He might forget. So we had a huge vocabulary of songs at that point. But I looked at it a way. You see, it was more that we provided a cover for young people, especially. There was a certain amount, to take the homophobia thing, it was pretty strong in society, and it was strong in Irish American society. But here, we had this huge following of young Irish Americans who might not be, down with gay rights. But now there's a song about a construction worker who's also a great football player, who will take your head off. You call him a faggot, So that made these guys think, this is the Black 47 song. Maybe I should think about this in a different way. And the juxtaposition was on purpose. I mean, I took the Danny Boy because, as you say, it is the big romantic Irish-American song. Made him an Irish gay, tough construction worker. So you're not talking about the lily-handed guys. It's, this guy will take your head off. He almost takes the foreman's head off at a 2x4. So it was like, whoa, now you got to deal with this new stereotype. So that's what we were doing all the time, was taking those. And say for the song on the Iraq album, Downtown Baghdad Blues, I used Minstrel Boy, which is the big pipe song, the big bagpiper song, as a motif in that, you know, to, because now all of a sudden you're hearing da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, but you're singing about Iraq. It's like it turns people's heads around.
Yeah, I mean, like, as somebody who's been politically active, let's say, over the last 25 years or more, we're in a situation now, I mean, you left Ireland.
Yeah.
So Sinn Féin were pariahs, essentially.
They were pariahs, yeah.
And now, 40 years later, Sinn Féin are in the polls, the most popular party, and you have what ostensibly seems like a rising happening again, in reference to like the water charges.
Yeah.
I mean, do you see that as a certain a hopeful element within Ireland?
Yeah, definitely. It shakes things up, you know. I mean, you had the Fianna Fáil, Fine Gael, Labour, three parties that, you know, I wouldn't say they didn't stand for anything, but it was to make things work, and you're missing the idealism. And when you take the idealism out of a society, then there's nothing for people to reach for. You know?
Yeah.
So I see it as a really healthy thing.
Yeah.
I mean, you're always, everything is a battle between pragmatism and principles and how you balance them. And it sweeps one way, it sweeps another. Mm-hmm. But if you don't have the two of them together, in some way, it doesn't work. But it's got to go lopsided in one way or another at different times for it to get back to the center.
Yeah,
I've always thought.
Yeah. Right, we're going to wrap it up. I mean, I'm just going to ask you one more question. I mean,
sure.
At the back end of 25 years with Black 47,
mm-hmm.
I mean, do you see yourself in a situation now? I mean, I presume you're going to continue with the writing, going to play a bit and whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, is that what you see yourself doing over the next few years? Or?
You know, in a weird way, Black 47 was such a special thing. I've spent the last, I decided on stage actually last September at a festival in Buffalo that I'd never heard the band sound as good. And then on the way back in the van, I was thinking, wow, you know, maybe this is the time to go out. And I brought it up to the other guys and we decided to go out on our 25th birthday, which would give everybody a year to do things
mm-hmm.
or to decide what to do. But in essence, we did 2 years of gigs in 1 year, and I really didn't have time to think. It was, how do you bring this thing to a good end and tie it up right? Mm-hmm. So I've been just so involved with that for the last year that I haven't really given a lot of thought. I am doing a lot of things. I have a musical called Hard Times. It looks like it'll go to Broadway.
That's the work of it's you and using Stephen Foster.
Stephen Foster, yeah. I actually did it here this time last year. Did a solo version of it here. But as soon as I get back from the States, I got to go to Toronto and work on that. So I'll be doing that and I'll do some solo stuff. But I haven't actually thought about what to do as regards music, you know, as a solo person, because I've just been concentrating on. We did an album and everything. We did two albums in the last year, so it was a lot of work last year. I'm still going from a year ago. Tonight is kind of the end of it, and I go to Dublin tomorrow and go back to New York. And it's Thanksgiving, I'll actually get a chance to think. But I have a new book coming out, A History of Irish Music as I've Seen It, which will deal with my early days here in Wexford and Shauna Reid and all that, and bringing it right up to walking on cars and people like that.
Well, I tell you what, no matter what you do, it's going to be contentious, it's going to be enjoyable, and I look forward to it. We only had 10 minutes, I'm sure we've done 20, and I could have done 20 minutes more. Larry, a pleasure, thank you very much.
Thanks for having me, and it's great to be back in Wexford, even if it's only for 15 hours. I always take Wexford with me, even though I don't come back, it's very much in my head.
Well, we don't let you go. You're always Larry Kirwan of Wexford. Thank you very much.